Good morning. My name is Michael Gonzalez. I am the Vice Chairman for the Illinois Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation, and we welcome you to our 14th conference here in Rosemont at the Donald E. Stevens Convention Center. Now, I'd like to take a page out of someone we lost this year, and that is Muhammad Ali. And you knew that he would always say, "I am the greatest." So I think that Ruben Castillo is the greatest chief judge in the federal court system. I think that Nancy De Los Santos is the greatest. I think Representative Elizabeth Hernandez and Senator Iris Martinez, Cynthia Soto, Fred Crespo, Eddie Acevedo, Senator Martin Sandoval, Antonio Munoz, I think they're the greatest. I think State Controller, our elect, Susana Mendoza, and Senator-elect Cristina Castro, they're the greatest. I think Dr. Jose Torres, Carmen Velasquez, and many of our other presenters today, they are the greatest. I think that Ron Perlman, Sylvia Rogel, Jim Zabel, Sally Gonzalez, Leila Suleiman, Alejandro Moran, Daniela Campos, I think they're the greatest. And I think I'm the greatest. Now, my sisters would agree that as a young man, I used to say that a lot. And maybe that just meant that I had a good image of myself, or maybe I knew I was going somewhere. And I think all of you, everyone that's in this room, is the greatest. Say that to each other today throughout the proceedings. We are the greatest. And the reason I mention all of this is all of you know that Hillary Clinton last week, she received the majority of American voters' support. Yet, we are facing a presidency, and I'm going to quote Washington Post columnist Eugene Robinson. We're facing a presidency with an individual that utilized a campaign that featured bigotry and racism, stigmatizing Mexicans and Muslims, vile misogyny. That was part of that campaign. We should never forget mendacity, vulgarity, the ugliness, the insanity of that campaign. Please listen. Today, the foundation is facilitating opportunities through the conference proceedings for employment, input into public policy, and setting of the legislative agenda. And perhaps most importantly, simply networking with each other. We cover major areas of interest where we, all of us here, we will contribute greatly with our awesome skill sets that collectively make us the greatest response to silly campaign assertions that unfortunately got the candidate elected. Now, just remember what Hillary Clinton said, I think just yesterday. America is worth it. Let's fight for our values, and let's never give up. That's my little piece. And again, I want to welcome everybody to the 14th Annual Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation Conference. We're delighted we have planned an exciting and informative conference for you. You're going to learn a lot. You're going to help celebrate Latino achievements. And we are all energized to work toward even more success for our Illinois Latino community in the future. One thing I wanted to mention, we now have a better partnership with CAN-TV. CAN-TV is a cable station, and they'll be covering today's proceedings throughout to the largest extent that we've ever had them. And all of the proceedings from this morning and this afternoon will be broadcast in mid to late December. So please check your local listings and our website for broadcast times and channels and for links to the individual sessions. So all the sessions will be covered, and those will be posted on the website in January. So now at this time, I mentioned two greatest people, Senator Iris Martinez and Representative Elizabeth Hernandez, co-chairs of the Illinois Legislative Caucus Foundation. Please come up and make your remarks.
Thank you, Michael. Isn't Michael the greatest? Yeah, let's give him a hand, because he's the greatest too. Good morning, buenos dias. Okay, are we awake? Buenos dias. Ah, have some more coffee. Have some more coffee. It's a long day. But more important, thank you. Again, thank you very much. Thank you, Michael. On behalf of all the members of the Illinois Latino Legislative Caucus Foundation, welcome to our 14th annual conference. Wow, 14 years. I can't believe it's been 14 years since we started this. And the room just keeps getting bigger. The attendance keeps getting bigger. And I'm so thankful because it's just great to see everybody getting engaged in the issues that matter around the whole entire state. Latinos are everywhere in the state of Illinois. Guess what? And we're growing, and we're not going anywhere, okay? We're going to just get bigger and bigger. Our families are going to get bigger. In 2002, Latino members of the Illinois Legislative, as well as other leaders in our community, convened to create an organization with three main purposes: to develop, through the Illinois Latino Public Policy Institute, a new generation of informed, skilled, and effective Latino leaders who will help shape public policy; to provide college scholarships for our outstanding Latino men and women who are pursuing their educational goals; and third, to empower Illinois Latinos by increasing understanding and access to federal, state, and community programs in areas such as employment, immigration, health, human services, education, business, and development of civic leadership. As you will discover today, our annual conference helps to realize these purposes of the ILLCF. And this year, more than ever, we come together to turn the fear and uncertainty that our community is living into strength and action and, most important, power. Just take a look at this room, and you will see that the power is in this room and out there in the state of Illinois. Again, thank you for your participation. We look forward to a great day. May I now introduce to you State Representative Elizabeth Hernandez, the co-chair of the Latino Caucus.
Thank you, Iris. Today is a good day. Today is a good day. Remember, in these unsettling times, we are going to conduct our days as normal days. Remember that, please. Latinos in particular right now feel unsettled. Let's embrace each other and move on as a normal day. Let me start by thanking you for being here today. I would like to take this opportunity to emphasize that the goal of this conference today is not just to address serious issues of importance to Latinos and to explore, in particular, employment pathways for our community. This is also a day to celebrate the aspirations and successes of our Illinois Latino community, because we have met successes. For example, at noon, we will enjoy our scholarship luncheon, keynote speaker Nancy de los Santos Reza, and we will honor 25 outstanding college students who will receive the Illinois Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation college scholarships, recognizing their achievements and their promise as future leaders in our community. And also, and this is exciting, you may know we have something new this afternoon, and you don't want to miss our first Café con Leche with legislators right after lunch. an opportunity to get up close and personal with individual legislators, to learn about their work, and to share your ideas about policy, legislation, action we are looking for to come up. This is really an opportunity to get to know your legislator. I really recommend you to be there. We're really excited about that segment. Finally, you are all invited to a reception at the end of the day when we hope to have an opportunity to meet and talk with you and reflect on this day. It is now my great honor to introduce to you His Honor, Ruben Castillo, Chief Judge of the United States District Court for the Northern District of Illinois. It is very rare for our conference to hear from someone as distinguished as Judge Castillo. Born, raised, and educated right here in Chicago, he has worked in private law practice as an assistant U.S. attorney for the Northern District and as regional counsel for the Mexican-American Legal Defense Fund. In 1994, he was nominated and confirmed to a seat on the United States District Court. Upon his confirmation, he became the first Latino federal judge in the state of Illinois. What an honor. That is. Please help me welcome Chief Judge Ruben Castillo, who is our opening keynote speaker for this year.
Wow, this is really an honor to be here. I want to thank Senator Martinez, Representative Hernandez, all the people that worked on this great conference. To be at the 14th annual conference is really something that I will always remember. I know it's come a long way since people like Ron Perlman and former Senator Miguel Del Valle, my good friend, really organized this, and the conference has expanded every year. And yes, we are not going away. We are here to stay, Latinos in Illinois. I have to be careful about giving political speeches, but I'm going to call this my perspectives on different things. And I speak as someone who was born in Illinois, the proud son of a Mexican immigrant from a little town called Huajuapan in Oaxaca, and the proud son of a mother from Puerto Rico. And I'll tell you, the first thing that you can say from that is my perspective is about what this conference is all about, Latino unity. So more than ever, after whatever occurred last week, we need to be united. We need to be united. So let's do that and do it as my parents raised me to do every single thing that I do. And that is the famous word that all of you have heard, and that is con ganas, con ganas. That's what this conference is all about, to have the ganas to keep going in the face of adversity. Because I don't need to tell you how I feel about what occurred last week. You just heard from Representative Hernandez. I was appointed in 1994, and all of you know your history. You know who was the president in 1994, so you know what party I belong to. That's all I need to say. But I tell you, what I want to review with you is the good, the bad, and the ugly. And before I do that, I always have to start out telling the truth about every single thing. And for you to put this all in perspective is you need to know a little bit more about me and some of the things that I've done. And it's true, right out of law school, and I'm just a Chicago kid, grew up around Grandin, Ashland, probably have seen most of you at Nuevo León on 18th Street when it was open. And, my dad and I are still suffering from not getting that fix every week. but we do what we have to do. And I will tell you, I consider myself just a West Side kid. And how did I get to where I got to? I would say my parents, just like with all of you. And I think more than ever, because my story about being a son of an immigrant is replicated 1,000 times over in this room. More than ever, I think it's important for us to get our story out there, for our history to be known, the history of contributions that have been made over and over again to the state, to the city, by immigrants, and that will continue to be made. So I'll tell you this, if being the chief judge makes you all feel a little bit better that I am serving as the chief judge in the Northern District of Illinois, which covers not only the city of Chicago, but all the way to the border of another state up north of us that I'm kind of upset about, but that's all I'm gonna say about that. But my district is the Northern District of Illinois, and my state is Illinois. So if all of you feel better because I am there as a Latino, as an immigrant son, then that makes my job worthwhile for me. If you feel better about that, because those are the kind of contributions we're making all the time. It's the type of contribution we've seen now with the election of our new controller, with the election of our new U.S. Senator. And that brings to mind another thing that is gonna be very important as we go forward with Ganas, and that is the importance of coalitions. Because Senator Del Valle will tell you, one of the things I worked at when I was at the Mexican-American Legal Defense Fund was using the rule of law and voting rights to create the Hispanic Congressional District that is now very ably represented by Representative Gutierrez, and a big proponent of immigration reform. And we need immigration reform. Let's not give up on immigration reform as we go future, no matter what anyone is saying. I think the tide will turn on immigration. And let me just say, the proudest thing that I do as a U.S. District Court judge is swear in new citizens to this country. And when I look out at their faces and they see somebody like me, whose dad is from Oaxaca, Mexico, and I tell them that, I see the same type of response that I see in your faces, as they can empathize and identify with that. And I tell them right then and there as they're being sworn in that our national motto is E Pluribus Unum, which in Latin means out of many, one. Unlike what other people have been selling over this last election season, our national motto is not every man for himself. That's not what our country is all about. Our country is all about is bringing diversity from every single element. Whatever community, Muslim, gay, transgender, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Of course, the Latino community is very ably represented in that immigration mix. So my view is, as we go forward with Ganas, let's not give up on immigration reform. Let's realize what the history of this country is all about. We've been through, I can tell you, in previous years, going back 200 years, we've seen things like the Know Nothing Party and other anti-immigrant sentiments expressed, and we survived that, and we will survive the era that we're in, because after all, the branch of government that I represent is about rule of law. It's about rule of law. And we have to look at that and say progress has been made. We cannot forget that progress has been made. In fact, right before I became chief judge here in the Northern District of Illinois, how can we forget? that we got the great Justice Sonia Sotomayor, proud Puerto Ricana, appointed to the U.S. Supreme Court. And I will tell you, she ably represents our sentiments on the Supreme Court every day. But more work needs to be done. And right now, you'd want to know this, there are about 125 proud federal judges, judges like Gonzalo Curiel, who I know in San Diego, who's from Indiana, great guy. I was a prosecutor with his brother. We prosecuted a lot of cases together. Tony Curiel was one of the first federal prosecutors in Chicago. And his brother went out to California and was named to the federal bench. There's 125 Latino and Latina federal judges ably serving the United States, most of them of immigrant background of one kind or another. Because let us not forget, all of us, no matter what nationality we are of immigrant background, unless we happen to be Native Americans, and we can work our coalition with them too. We'll work our coalition with everyone. And let me just tell you some of the places where there are either Latino or Latina chief judges, places that you don't even think about. So you know about Chicago, because I'm here, but how about Seattle? How about San Diego? How about Brooklyn, New York? You know, in Brooklyn, New York, got its first ever Hispanic judge when my good friend Dora Irisari was appointed to the court. And I just couldn't believe it because I was at her swearing in. And she's a Puerto Ricana, born in the Bronx. A great story, just like Sonia Sotomayor, went to Columbia Law School, well-deserving of everything she's accomplished. But it wasn't until 2003 that the first person of Latino background in one of the most diverse communities in the United States, Brooklyn, New York, was appointed to the Federal District Court. 2003, and it was a Republican who appointed her because she happens to be from the Republican Party. And I will tell you, I was so proud of that fact that I took my mother, who was alive at that time, and we went to her swearing in. It was an event that I will never, ever forget, but it's also made me reflect on why did we have to wait until 2003 to diversify the court in Brooklyn? And there are other courts that need to be diversified. That's what I will tell you. There's a progress has been made every time, but work needs to be done. And we cannot lose our ganas to do that work. There are only 15 of those 125 federal judges who are serving on the Court of Appeals. That is the second highest court other than the U.S. Supreme Court. And I will tell you, in Chicago, the Federal Court of Appeals, the court that reviews my work and the work of all my colleagues on my court, sits in a three-state area. And that takes in Wisconsin, that state that I didn't want to mention, Indiana, and Illinois. That's our three states. That's the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals. There's never, ever been a Latina or a Latino on that court. Never, despite all the years that court has been in existence. So yet to this day, we as a community have not desegregated that court. Can you believe that? That's today's history. So I have to tell you, as I say, I don't pull any punches, just like Muhammad Ali. You know, we have work to be done. And I have to tell you what is good. Progress is being made. We had the results of the election last week, and Illinois did pretty well on a diversity standpoint. When you think of Comptroller Mendoza and all the progress we're making, but you know, and Senator Duckworth, but work needs to be done. We just cannot give up the ganas to do that work. Let me talk about some other things that I think are critical. And I just love the agenda that you put together for this conference, because you're hitting all the critical points. These are the points that I used to work on at the Mexican-American Legal Defense Fund, because what we worked on at the Mexican Legal Defense Fund were education, employment, voting rights, and immigration. And those are four key areas for the Latino community all the time. Now, I know that you've expanded, rightfully so, and I'm not an expert, so I'm not gonna talk a great deal about any of the other two issues you're talking about, which are energy and healthcare, two vital areas for our community as we go into the future, because we have to plan ahead in order to succeed. That is how we make progress. There's no other way than to plan where you want to get to and then hope to get there. And I think every single one of our Latino and Latina federal judges have gone through that process. But education, which I know is the next topic you're going to be taking up as the conference goes on, is critical, because that is our pipeline. That is our pipeline. And most of our gente are in public education. And it is critical that the funding for public education be one that is fair, that is equal as we can make it. And I will tell you, there is where I think the U.S. Supreme Court has kind of let us down. And I'm not here to give a legal lecture, but do you know that the Supreme Court had a chance back before I even went to law school to make education, to declare that education was a fundamental right in the United States? And they declined to do so. I think if there was one decision that I could change from the U.S. Supreme Court, that would be it. Because if education was a fundamental right in the United States, then there would have to be equal funding to get that education. And that's exactly what most communities don't have. Because too often right now, where you grow up decides what type of public education you're having. And that is hurting. So what I see as the bad about our education is how we are funding education. What I see as the ugly of our education is that too much of our education is still in 2016 segregated. Too much of it. And maybe that's just a problem with the beautiful city that I grew up in, but we need to keep our eye on that and see how we can advance the cause of education and make funding for public education a little bit fairer. And don't let anyone lecture us on how we should fund public education. We need to be as proactive as we can. Just like I was happy when Michael brought up his in-laws, you know, because it always used to kill me, and I know I'm digressing a little bit here, but it always used to kill me when other people would come in and lecture Latinos on family values. We've heard what family values are. And I always used to say, when I was a younger man, and I still say now as an older man, I want to know when the last time that person who is lecturing us on family values went on a family vacation with their in-laws and actually had a good time. Because you all have done that. You all respect what being an abuelo is, an abuelita, un tío. You all respect that, but not everybody else. Everybody else, they don't really talk to their children. And we talk to our children all the time. We know what family values are. So we should not allow other people to lecture us on family values, on education, on all of the things that are critical to our well-being. We need to speak up more than ever for ourselves, because this is a critical time. Now, let me move on to a couple of things that I know probably way too much about, and that is criminal justice reform. I would hope that the caucus would look at this issue because I will tell you, as a former prosecutor, as one who served with somebody like Tony Cudiel in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and believe me, I sent lots of people to jail. But I will tell you, we're not going to incarcerate ourselves out of the crime problem. We need to be more compassionate about how we look at the crime problem. We need to bring more resources, and we need to do more social welfare, believe it or not, so that we can holistically put together broken communities that are out there. And one of the things I'm doing at the federal court right now is working on reentry programs, because one of the things that I was privileged to do under President Clinton, not only did he appoint me in 94 to the district court, but in 1999, he came back to me and said, would you serve on something called the U.S. Sentencing Commission? And so I thought to myself, well, why would I do that? That seems to be something that I'm not sure is career enhancing. But you know what? It was my responsibility to do so. And one of the things I did on the U.S. Sentencing Commission was, believe it or not, was lower the penalties at the federal level for drug crimes. And we ended up releasing mainly minority men who had been incarcerated for way too long. And you know what? Nothing bad happened as a result of that. Nothing bad, because if anything bad had happened as a result of that, you all would know about it. The papers would be all over it. CNN would be all over it. But what is not happening is that the papers are not publicizing that our release of more than 20,000 individuals is being done successfully, that we are, for the first time, closing down federal prisons. And my prediction is that even with the transition of power that will occur in Washington, D.C., there will still be a movement to reform criminal justice at the federal level and at the state level. This was accomplished in Texas. This can be accomplished in Illinois. This needs to be accomplished because we cannot afford to damage the communities that are being damaged by the penalties that are way too long, that accomplish very little. We need to put more resources on helping individuals get their lives back together, get their families back together. And so now I'm sitting around tables like yours, round tables like this, with former federal prisoners, talking to them about making better decisions. And I can tell you, the more time we spend with individuals and treat them like human beings, the better off we are. We need to bring more compassion into this equation. And I will tell you, as a former trial attorney, the drug war is a failure. It's a failure. And I don't hesitate to say that. Just today, and this is what I was going to get to, as a former trial attorney, I like to carry around exhibits. So my exhibit today, which I just grabbed from the Chicago Sun-Times, Surgeon General just released a report. 1 in 7 in U.S. will suffer addiction. And this whole story talks about how the Surgeon General is advising a fundamental change in treatment, emphasizing compassion over incarceration. Emphasizing compassion over incarceration. This is what I've been talking about. This is what I've spent 10 years of my life trying to accomplish at a national level. So I'm happy to see a report come out like that. We might not see a report like that in the future, but that report is out there. It is food for thought. It is food for thought for this caucus in terms of what Illinois is doing, how we can save money, how we can stay focused, how we can accomplish greater good for our community, because that needs to be done. There's one other point that I need to address. As somebody who's been in law enforcement and is part of where we need to make progress, the good part of this story is that every day, I can tell you from my own experience, Latinos are making a tremendous contribution in terms of law enforcement. And I tell you that as someone who, when he was at MALDEF, sued entities like the Chicago Police Department, like the federal government, in order to make sure that Latinos and Latinas were promoted at acceptable levels. And I wish more diversity had been brought into law enforcement. Because if that had been done in those days, and I'm talking about the 80s and the early 90s, if that had been done, we wouldn't have the bad police community relations we currently have right now. Because that, to me, is part of the ugly of what exists right now. It's something that needs to be repaired. It's something that is damaging our community. It's damaging the African American community. It's part of a natural topic that we can form an alliance with the African American community and work on reforming the police department. It's no secret that there will probably be a consent decree in federal court that will govern the Chicago Police Department at some point. I will not be assigned to that case. I know that as chief judge, but there's going to be opportunity for input, opportunity to do as well as we can. So my message to you, there's a lot of work to be done in all of these areas. That, as Michael said, our values, fundamentally, family values, hard work, tener ganas siempre, they will make tremendous contributions to our country. We have a lot of views that need to be heard. We are represented on the federal bench. We still have progress to be made. One of the things I haven't talked in terms of my court is that I desperately need Latinas on my court. So I'm hoping that some of you will come and join our court and contribute, because one of the things that I have to tell you is our judges on the court are not getting any younger. We're getting a little bit older, and I include myself in that category. I like to think of it as wiser, but we need to see the next generation move forward. So I'm hoping that you have the ganas to keep going and make that achievement with the help of the great people here at the conference, help of the caucus. We can stay focused on keeping the pipeline going into all the professions and make the progress we need to make, because ultimately these are things that are family values that are passed on to us, passed on to us. I still remember to this day how proud my parents were when I became, back then, this is what they called it, an altar boy, not an altar server. Now we have at least some gender equality in altar servers. But back then, when I used to draw the short straw and get the 6:30 mass, I remember my mother would come with me. She'd say, "Yo voy contigo." And we'd go to 6:30 mass. And then it got even better, because these are lessons that you'll never forget. So came the 7:15 mass, and the altar servers for that mass didn't show up. And she would say, "Mijito, why don't you stay and help the priests and serve the mass?" And then she would lead by example. She would say, "And I'll stay with you for that second mass." And I will tell you, that example to this day, this is what drives me. This is what drives me. This is what gives me the ganas to always keep going, to always keep going. And if I do nothing else this morning, is all I can do is wish you the best conference that I can and tell you that I will keep those ganas going, and I know you will. And don't let any results of last week throw you off, because we are here to stay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Judge Castillo. You are definitely, you know, very humbling, but you know what? We're so proud of the work that you've done, and more important is that we have to continue to grow the bench with more Latino and Latinas. That's the honest truth. I think we do here in Illinois. We're trying to increase those numbers. We got to keep our Supreme Court justices, you know, on their toes as far as making these appointments, especially when we have vacancies, but we have to keep encouraging our young men and women who right now are in the law offices, to, you know, to start looking at sub-circuit districts and start knowing that, you know, there's a lot of support for you. We just need to make sure that, you know, you step up and to the plate and know that we need to really diversify more and more our courts, especially because when you look at our court system, the most incarcerated are the black and brown. So I think that as we continue to hear the words of encouragement from our judge, I think it's very important that when he says that we need more men and women, especially on the federal courts, absolutely. Right here in Illinois, we need more judges that look like us on the bench. So thank you very much. And now I just want to ask the judge to come back up here because we want to present him with a very special award. And you know, I think his career, stellar career, says it all. As you know, he just shared, you know, a lot of perspective today with what he wants to keep on doing. And I want to just say that the Illinois Latino Legislative Latino Caucus Foundation honors you today with this award for all the work that you have done for representing us in the courts on a federal level, but more important, representing a true Latino born and raised in this state, you know, and has prosper so much, and we have to live by the example. To all the young men and women in this room who are thinking about law school, talk to the judge today. You know, find out how we can continue to help you move along. Maybe one of our today's recipients, scholarship recipient, will continue. If they're in law school, you know what? We want to continue to help you make sure that you fulfill your dreams. On behalf of the Illinois Latino Legislative Caucus Foundation, is proud of your numerous accomplishments, including first Latino chief federal judge for the Northern Illinois District. Ladies and gentlemen, please give him a round of applause.
Muchas gracias. Que Dios los bendiga. Es todo lo que puedo decir. I want to congratulate also the scholarship winners and thank the caucus for all you're doing and for this unexpected honor. Thank you very much.
And now I'm going to ask Ms. Sylvia Villa if she can come up. Sylvia Villa? Sylvia Villa. There she is. So I'm... We're going to give her a minute because I'd like for her to come up before I start. Let's give her a round of applause. Sylvia. So we want to recognize Sylvia. I have to tell you, I'm very, very proud to have the opportunity to honor Sylvia Villa with this Community Service Award on behalf of the Latino Caucus. Sylvia is currently the Director of Marketing and Community Relations at Aunt Martha's Youth Service Center, a federally qualified health center, and leads a team of community health workers who are from Joliet to Chicago Heights, to Aurora and Kankakee, engaging families to make sure they have access to quality health care and the right tools to keep their families healthy and thriving. Sylvia's commitment to the Latino community spans more than 25 years, and many of you in this room, like me, have benefited from her extraordinary vision and leadership. I had the opportunity to get to know Sylvia when she moved to the Department of Human Services and created a national model of Collaboration for Immigrant Services, most of you know as the Illinois Welcoming Centers. Yes, indeed. It was her. Her vision and drive has resulted in thousands of families getting support, communities coming together to solve problems and strengthen the way they work with immigrant families through community collaboratives, and millions of additional dollars coming in to support children, youth, and seniors throughout the NOW network of 9 welcoming centers. For the past few years, I have counted on her guidance and leadership as a voice with the integrity and the depth of knowledge about the state policy and immigrant services. Sylvia, I want you to know that I, along with my colleagues at the caucus, will continue to champion the welcoming centers and thank you immensely for the legacy you have built as the creator of welcoming centers and as the director of the Office of Latino Affairs for the state. Thank you very much. Uh-oh, she's got her roboso on. That means something. Sylvia, please, a few words.
You know, I just found out by surprise this week that I was getting this award. I talked a lot to myself. I said, I'm not going to cry. So I have my grandmother's roboso. And thank you so much. There's so much I want to say, but si se puede. My grandmother taught me so much. This is for the first people that fought against the border. 1846 is the first time we fought against it. We fought Pancho Villa across the border, and we continue with that spirit. This is for the first immigrants that crossed the border. This is for the first Mexicanos that came to work in the steel mills. This is for the first college students. Some of us are the first ones to graduate. This is for the first Latina senator. This is for the first state representative Latina. There's so many firsts in this room, and there's a lot of young people here, and I do what I do because of all of you for a better future. And my rebozo today, the first feminist I met is my grandmother in Mexico City. And she said in Spanish, aquí mando yo, cabrones. And it's in that spirit that my grandmother said this rebozo would keep me safe. But when I needed to fight, I would put it across my chest, and I would fight for all of you. Thank you.
I like that saying. I got to use that in Springfield. And finally, let me acknowledge one more individual that sometimes people wonder what, you know, who are the people behind the scenes that make this happen. And we want to today really just acknowledge and really just present to this woman this award as someone that, you know, has been with us from day one, who has worked tirelessly on behalf of the foundation, who we feel that, you know what, without her, sometimes, you know, it's not possible to have successful year after year conferences. You know what? And from the beginning, she's been with us. You know, we appreciate everything she's done, her commitment, her dedication when it comes to the Caucus Foundation. And I just want to say on behalf of the Latino Caucus, thank you so much for everything you do for us. You know, we want to keep you around for the longest time ever, as long as we keep having these conferences. I want to bring up and acknowledge her, our good friend, Sally Gonzalez. Thank you, Sally. This is in recognition of your tireless efforts to help make the ILLCF conference always a success. Thank you very much for all your services to us.
Thank you.
sorry.
Oops. Well, I wouldn't be here without, of course, some people. And Michael Gonzalez, we happen to be related. He's my brother. But for all the other people, too, that work kind of behind the scenes, and more specifically, like all the people from the center, Ron Perlman, Jim Zabel, and more specifically, Sylvia Rogel, who has been around for quite a while herself. I just, you know, I mean, I enjoy this work. I get pissed off too, but, you know, in order to get things done, and we always have a deadline and all that kind of stuff, as people who know, you know, I mean, just daily work stuff even. So I just want to, you know, thank you for being recognized. And by the way, I'm looking for employment. For real, for real. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And let's just real quickly also just add and say thank you. Thank you to the Resource Center. I mean, Ron Perlman, where is he? Where's Ron? He's always working. But Ron Perlman, thank you. Thank you for really having your center there, really making these past 14 years of conferences possible. The commitment of all the workers there, all the volunteers that are here today, we want to just say thank you. Thank you for your commitment, but much more for the successful events that we've been having year after year, continues to grow, and that's because of the center. So Ron Perlman and the center, thank you very much for all you've done to us. Please, everyone, give the volunteers and everyone a round of applause, because they make it possible for us.